production support for the weekly special is provided by WTIU members. Thank you.
Tonight's episode of the weekly special is all about Hoosier homes. With cooler temperatures on their way, we're taking a look at what Hoosiers can do to prepare. We'll tag along on an energy audit of an area home, then practical tips you can do yourself, and meet a couple who has opened their home to scores of turtles and tortoises. Plus movie reviews in our See It or Skip It segment, and Fat Shadow is here to perform right now on the weekly special.
Hi, and welcome to the weekly special. I'm Pam Thrash. We've got a lot to talk about on tonight's show, so let's get started by heading over to the booth where Joe's sitting down with our first guest. Hi, Joe.
Hi, Pam. And we're joined by the City of Bloomington's Sustainability Coordinator, Jackie Bauer, to talk about energy efficiency. Hello. Thanks for being here. Hard to believe that time of the year where we're switching our thermostat to air conditioning and then back to heat and air again. Yes. But it's also that time that you help homeowners become efficient with their homes.
Yeah, that's right. So energy efficiency is one of the best investments you can make. If anyone came to you with the deal you could get on energy efficiency in the form of a stock investment or something like that, you would jump all over it. Some of these types of investments have 3 to 5 year returns. So it's a great way to save money. It's a great way to make your home more comfortable. And it is that time of year.
So. And we went along with a home energy audit, and we have that right now.
Great.
Typical home energy assessment costs around $300.
All right, let's see what you got in here.
But not this one.
You could do many, many things. You could start with a furnace, you could start with insulation, you could do your windows, and we don't really know what the first step is. And I think where we would need advice is where our money is going to get the biggest bang for the buck.
Homeowners Martin Bout and Andrea Havel signed up as soon as they heard about the free assessments this fall.
All the energy efficiency standards in this house are all from the 1950s. So that means that it's a fantastic house, but I don't think that it is as insulated as it could be. Mm-hmm. And you know, the materials that they used back then are, of course, of completely different quality than they use now. So
making a big difference in their energy bills.
In the winter months and summer months, about three in the winter, three in the summer, it's at least three times higher.
And that's what these assessments are for. Ted Mendoza is the auditor for this assessment. He inspected the house from basement.
Oh, it's pretty cold.
To the attic.
There's a lot that could also be done here. Just the insulation alone.
Yeah.
You can put more down here. You can also put some roll-up bat insulation in between these rafters here.
Yeah. Ted used a temperature detection device to pinpoint drifts of cold air leaking into the house.
You can also see on the scale below, the dark means 54. So you can see there on that right by there, and then also down towards the bottom of the door there, and air just kind of gets in there and just kind of works its way around. So weatherizing your doors, weatherizing your windows.
In their final evaluation, Martin and Andrea agree with Ted that insulating the attic and weatherizing doors is the best investment right now. In the end, saving money, but also living greener.
Interesting. I was just reading where the typical U.S. family spends close to $1,500 a year on home energy bills. If you can reduce that in any way, that's a huge cost saving, too.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And there's so many things that people can do themselves. Lauren will demonstrate some of that. There's lots of cool tools that people can have. This is sort of the poor man's version of what you saw in the clip there. This is a laser thermometer that lets you sort of point and pick up what temperatures, where's cold and where's hot. This is a kilowatt, which let you can plug something into this and figure out how much energy it uses. So you can figure out what items in your homes you use the most energy. But there's lots of things that people can do themselves. You can also do an energy audit like you see on the clip. But you can also hire a professional who can do the kind of bigger things like insulating your attic and insulating your basement and making sure that your home is as efficient as it can be. And like I said, this stuff pays for itself within a matter of years.
Can you pick these up anywhere?
You can. You can. These cost $20 to $30 the kilowatts.
Oh, that's not bad at all.
Same for the, I think the laser thermometers may be $30-$40.
You can always put your hand up to that window, but this here, when you see
absolutely
the temperature difference, it's really amazing,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, and you can see where air is actually coming in under baseboards and that kind of thing. You can see where that cold air is versus up at the ceiling, it'll be warmer. So I think most people get that you know, hot air rises, but you know what that actually does is suck cold air in wherever it can find a hole. So.
Well, it was nice. We have Pam here who brought in her kitchen window and her door from home for us just to demonstrate some of these tips.
Right. We have Lauren Sumpner.
Yes.
And with Sumpner Building Services, and you're going to give us some do-it-yourself tips that people can do fairly simply and cost-effectively at home. What do you want to show us first?
Well, there's lots of things people can do on their own at home, and a lot of that is the accessible parts of the house, such as doors, windows, attic hatches, crawl space hatches, things that they can reach easily.
Okay.
We've got a few products here that a homeowner may use. We'll start with the weather stripping. These are gaskets that you can put on your outlets or light switches in your home, which will reduce the cold air infiltration from those
areas. I did not
realize
that, and that's really inexpensive.
Exactly,
yeah.
Maybe a dollar for a pack of 10 of these.
Okay.
The same with weather stripping. The weather stripping can be used on your window, your doors in your house, a few other spots, and this again is only a couple dollars to buy at the local hardware store.
Okay.
You want to put that on the perimeter of your windows, the perimeter of your door, interior or exterior doors.
Okay.
Another material you can buy at the hardware store is expanding foam.
Okay.
And this can be used on some larger areas in your house that are leaking more air. This stuff is not as sightly as some other materials, but for an area in your home that nobody sees or is hidden, expanding foam can really reduce air infiltration.
Right.
And for a more extensive project of foam, you could buy an operation like this at a local insulation store.
Okay.
And go ahead.
No, go ahead. Keep telling me. I'm like taking notes in my head here. Because it's never too late or too soon to get this done, to save some
correct
money.
Yeah.
Right.
This will help. Mostly in the winter, we're more of a heating climate here. We spend more money heating our homes than cooling.
Okay.
But also in the summer, it'll help keep the hot air out of your house.
Right, right. And then we have here.
For areas in your house that are more visible, you want to use some caulking.
Okay.
And we've got just a typical caulking here that you'll use around your baseboard, around your trim in your home, around doors and windows, and an area that is more visible. You want something that does not jump out at you as much something like a foam.
Do you have a suggestion on what you would do first if none of this had been done to somebody's house?
Well, as Jackie mentioned, in your house, the hot air likes to rise, and so it looks for areas high in your home, in the second floor or near the ceiling to escape, and that allows cold air to enter your house lower.
Okay.
So you want to start maybe at in the second floor of your home or around windows in that area, and then kind of move your way down to the ground level.
Okay. Lauren, thank you so much for the tips that you gave us today. Joe, do you already do that to your house? Or
yes,
have you?
Yes, and
yeah?
Great tips. Appreciate it. Thank
Absolutely.
You so much. And we're just going to close here with if people want more information, where can they go?
People can go to our website at www.bloomington.in.gov/energy-resources. And there's links on that website to all kinds of different websites that should help people learn how to do things themselves and get professional help and all kinds of stuff.
And Energy Star, is there good stuff on there too?
EnergyStar.gov is linked from that same website. And they've got a nice do-it-yourself ceiling and insulating guide that walks people through all kinds of great stuff. So.
Great. Well, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much for having me.
Learned a lot. And next up, from caring for our own homes to creating a home for others who need care. And in this case, we're talking turtles. The Weekly Special contributing producer Lene Shawansky brings us the story.
If you look in Marty LaPrise's backyard, you'll see turtles, turtles, and more turtles. LaPrise has turned her New Palestine home into a nonprofit turtle and tortoise sanctuary, rehabilitation center, education facility, and conservatory called Indiana Turtle Care.
When I really got involved, I had two box turtles, and people started finding out that I had these box turtles, and this was before the internet. So there wasn't much information. So I started reading and learning and things, and people would call me out of the clear blue and say, I hear that you know a little bit about turtles. Could you help me with this? And I thought, you know, I think I'm gonna really take the next step. You want a tomato?
She is now a licensed turtle and tortoise rehabilitator and works with local veterinarians, rescue organizations, and the Department of Natural Resources to rehabilitate the injured creatures.
Don't they look like E.T.?
LaPrise is one of the only turtle and tortoise rehabilitators in the area, so she receives a number of hurt, sick, and even confiscated turtles. LaPrise says she does a lot of shell repair on turtles that have been run over by a car or lawnmower or were bitten by a dog. These turtles and tortoises stay inside where they can receive the proper attention.
With turtles, they take a long time to heal. It's not like a deer or a raccoon, you know, and they hurt themselves and they heal. But turtles take a long time to heal. So if they survive a trauma to the shell, if it's just a split, then I tend to wire it together. If there's individual pieces, some of them may not be viable, so I wait to see if I can somehow put them together. I may have to remove some pieces.
This is what happened to Penelope, a turtle found hit by a car on the streets of Indianapolis.
Luckily, she was found by the vet at the zoo. And she took her in and worked on her, and her whole side was gone. And they entrusted me to take her. Made me very nervous because they worked so hard, and I thought, oh boy, that, you know, these are the veterinarians at the zoo.
Amazingly, Penelope survived with only a part of her side missing. She now swims among a number of other turtles and is sometimes referred to as our miracle girl.
And she's doing great.
The LaPrises also have two Salcutta tortoises that are allowed to roam freely in the backyard because they've outgrown their prior habitats. LaPrise's husband, John, says Oglethorpe, who weighs between 20 and 25 pounds, is very trusting of his new home.
He follows you around, he knows his name, and when the weather is bad, he knows to go in to an enclosure where it's safe.
John says he has seen a big change in these turtles and tortoises' demeanor the longer they stay.
You get a turtle in from the wild, and after a few days of giving it attention, it's amazing how it lets down its defenses and trusts you. And the ones that have been here for a long time, how they come up and greet you just like a dog.
You can have just the worst day. And just come out and just kind of watch them, you know, and in the mornings come out with a cup of coffee, and because they're waking up, they like the sun and they're busy, and it's calming.
And we'd like to remind everyone at home that keeping turtles as pets is highly regulated in the state of Indiana. For information about turtle care, what you should do if you find a turtle, healthy or otherwise, and to learn more about the turtles and tortoises in Marty and John's care, visit IndianaTurtleCare.com. And now, Fat Shadow.
my treasures betrayed me again. I got nothing but blood to give, but I won't feed that myth. If it's them squeaky toes that keep you up, then I guess our troubled times, they ain't that.
Fat Shadow, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The crowd goes wild. So you guys are Bloomington-based, is
yes.
that right? And you're Dawn. Mm-hmm. You want to introduce us to the rest of the band?
Yeah, this is Aaron Toby on bass guitar.
Uh-huh.
And this is Jefferson Grant on drums. And Chris Mott on guitar.
Great. Now, something that you and I were talking about a little earlier is not only are you a band, but your own independent label, too.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, Aaron and Jeff run Houseplant Records.
Okay.
And that's what our album is out on.
And where can people find your music?
Houseplantrecords.com.
Okay. Now, do you have, something else different. You don't mm-hmm. have a CD out, you actually have an album.
Yeah, we have vinyl. We have a CD also, but the same album, but mainly we just did a big vinyl record.
Excellent. And you've got another song coming up at the end of the show?
We do.
We are looking forward to that.
Thanks.
But for now, we're gonna go back over to Joe.
Thanks, Pam. I'm joined by the director of the IU Cinema, John Vickers, for another segment of See It or Skip It. We have two films.
We do,
which
yes.
Which two?
50-50 and Dream House, both released this last week.
And we have a trailer. We're going to look at Dream House right now.
Okay, great.
Let's take a look.
Once upon a time, there were two little girls who lived in a house.
Yeah, you're home!
Hey, Will, come here.
Did you look at that? I wonder where they are now.
You live here and you don't know about the murders.
What murders?
The whole family was shot. The father survived.
Who did it?
The focus came down to the father.
Pete.
Let's make sure we're talking about the same man.
That's not Peter Ward. That's me.
You lived in this institution for 5 years, Peter.
No.
We released you 7 days ago.
You can't stay here.
Once upon a time, there were two little girls who lived in a house.
Well, there you go. Happy Halloween, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
I assume, is that our scary movie of the season?
It's a great season choice to review, I guess, right?
So what do you think?
Well, the film was directed by Jim Sheridan, who's done a number of great films like My Left Foot and The Boxer and In America. And has a great cast, definitely Daniel Craig, Rachel Weisz, and Naomi Watts. And it's part murder mystery, part psychological thriller, part, of course, haunted house slash ghost story. And it has a great premise. So it's a man that goes out, he's a successful editor, and he wants to write the great American novel, and goes and finds a house in the country with his wife and two children to do so. And it's certainly influenced by The Shining and some other films like Shutter Island. But midway, it takes a great plot twist, which you see part of in the trailer. But certain things throughout the film kind of lose sight of maybe some things. And so I often, during the film, I kind of rolled my eyes a little bit, or I even got frustrated with certain elements of the validity of certain things. But then it tries to wrap itself up at the end. And so it has some really, really great moments, and if you're patient and wait to the end for a payoff, it might be for you. But for me, I would have to say skip it, unfortunately.
Skip this one.
I would. You know, it has, again, some great moments, I was expecting something a little different, but it just didn't work in the end for me.
Okay, well, film number two, 50-50.
Yes.
Let's take a look at the trailer.
Okay, thanks.
You have cancer?
They found it yesterday.
They found it yesterday? Who found it?
My cleaning lady found it in the back of my jeans. Who do you think found it?
You're young. Young people beat cancer all the time. Every celebrity beats cancer. Dr. Dexter, Lance Armstrong, he keeps getting it.
I'm moving in.
No, Mom, no.
I'm your mother, Adam.
Wait, exactly.
Don't do it!
I thought you said you liked to do it.
You're gonna look weird.
Come on, let's just do it. What do you use this for?
My body tremors, so... What is it?
Hello?
It's Adam.
What's going on?
She's probably having a nervous breakdown.
What are your chances?
It said 50-50.
It's not that bad. If you were a casino game, you'd have the best odds.
Everybody's gotta live.
You really think that a girl's gonna go for me just because I have cancer?
For the millionth time, yes!
I have cancer.
I was wrong.
Nice
it was,
to meet
it
you.
Was weird. It's
yeah,
weird like that.
No, that's
it's not
too
it,
soon.
It doesn't sound cool.
50-50.
Nice head. Can I touch it?
You can do more than touch it.
A very interesting way to deal with the chronic illness. It seems sad, but it's funny. Does it work?
Yeah, I guess you wouldn't think maybe a cancer comedy would work. But in this case, great performances. Seth Rogen is a great, I think, supporting actor, and he does well in this. In this film, you would think that Joseph Gordon-Levitt's character, Adam, would have the most difficulties dealing with his cancer, but you find out that it's really everybody around him that's falling apart, and he's the most sane one in dealing with his illness. I think this works on many levels. It has enough Seth Rogen raunch for some audiences. It has great tender dramas, and then it treats the subject with a lot of respect. And so I think it's pulled off very, very well. And so I would have to say for this, you would want to see it. We had the opportunity of screening a sneak preview in the IU Cinema of this this film. And it was filled with students all the way up through older adults, and everyone loved it. So I think it's a good endorsement for the film.
Great. And, of course, speaking of the IU Cinema, you are the director. You have some neat films coming up this fall semester?
We do. We have a great Hitchcock and Herman series. Bernard Herman was the composer for 7 of Alfred Hitchcock's films, mm-hmm. so we're showing those six of those films. Mm-hmm. We have a number of guest filmmakers and many other things. And so we like to welcome people to come out to that as well.
And if people want more information, where can they go?
They can go to cinema.indiana.edu.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Had a great time.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Okay, thanks. And we'd also like to remind everyone to visit our website, theweeklyspecial.org, where you can see segments from this and past episodes, as well as take a look at what's coming up next week. And for now, we leave you with more from Fat Shadow. So for Pam Thrash, I'm Joe Wren. Good night.
Production support for The Weekly Special is provided by WTIU members. Thank you.